Looking in your hymnals, turn to page 245. Our next song is going to be More About Jesus. Song is Sweet Hour of Prayer on page 478.
Morning, happy Sabbath. Great to see all of you here today. I'm thinking I'm speaking to this mic or this mic, can't tell. But I would like to invite you to stand where you are now, turn to your neighbor or walk or give them a hug and welcome them and tell them that you're glad that they're here at the Haven Church. And we also had some snacks out in the lobby. Thank you so much. My son asked me what that big box is in the sanctuary, and I told them that's for naughty children, but I was not correct. That's not correct. That is a pending sound booth that we are moving down here, but I would volunteer to go in there because I was a naughty child when I was a kid. Did you serve? Have you served in the military? We are glad that you did, and if you're a veteran, we honor you this weekend and today, and we especially invite you on Monday at 10:30 to visit our Foothill School, where we will be raising a flag on raising a flag on the brand new flagpole. And so, yes, Jim? Yes. I don't know, Curtis. Right on the corner. Yeah, it's right on the corner of Munden, Sunnyside. 10:30 a.m. Yes. And if you haven't seen the new building as you've been driving by, it's incredible the amount of work that's going on with that, and I'm very grateful for all of that.
It's raining Monday. The event will still happen.
Yes. Thank you, Curtis. Rain or shine? Rain or shine. In Angwin, the Howell Mountain Mountaineers, did I say that right? Howell Mountaineers. The Pathfinders of the PUC Church will be distributing bags for our food pantry. And so this afternoon, expect a Pathfinder to come and drop a bag off. And then next Sabbath on the 16th, they'll be picking up food, canned goods for our Angwin food pantry. So watch for that this afternoon. And as a parent, a proud parent of a prep senior, I'm enthusiastic to announce that we have wreaths available for sale from the senior class. And so, yeah, those were emailed to you. Dino included that flyer, and I have a couple in my office if you'd like. So Christmas wreaths are available from the senior class at PUC Prep. Also wanted to make mention, happy birthday, Dougie. These flowers here are in honor of Dougie's birthday. Big Dad and I love you very much. So praise the Lord for their flowers. We hope that the magnetic love of God, the appeal of the Spirit, and the grace of Jesus overwhelm you today as we worship Him in spirit and truth.
Happy Sabbath. Good to see you all. Nice place to be on Sabbath morning. For those who are able, please kneel for our morning prayer. Father God, we come humbly before you today. Lord, we want to worship you in the beauty of holiness today. For you are our God, our deliverer, our Savior, our everything, Lord. And we thank you for that. You are the God of the nations, and the God of each individual heart here today. Lord, we come broken. We come, some of us sad, some of us happy, some of us perplexed, but we come. And we lay it at your feet today, thanking you for your marvelous gift of deliverance, Lord, may we take you at your word, and may we meditate daily and moment by moment upon your word and fellowship with you. Lord, as you said, deliver us from evil. And so, Lord, for the trials we're going through, we just pray that you would walk with us. Yea, though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because you are with me. And we thank you that you are constantly by our side. At times we lose our faith and we can't see clearly. But anoint our eyes with the salve of heaven. May we see your presence in everything that goes on around us. Lord, I pray for our vets today, and I thank you that we honor them. We thank you for their service to this country. I pray a blessing over each one of them, for the active ones, for the ones that are retired, and for the ones who have gone before us. Pray for our nation today, Lord. We're still at odds, and just pray for unity. Holy Spirit, descend upon our country, not only our country, but our world. Draw us into the unity of Jesus. Thank you for him being our all in all. Lord, today I pray for Pastor as he brings us the word. May we be attentive. May we hear the words you have from on high for each one of us. Thank you for your grace in our lives. We love you, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Where is everybody? Come on. Invite your friends, other members. This is a global mission offering, and the global mission is the frontline mission arm of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Through the use of the holistic ministry, global mission pioneers are bringing light to the cities of the world with a special focus on the 1040 window. Since global missions began 3 decades ago, we've reached many new people groups and entered new countries. I Will Go is the strategic plan of the Adventist Church for 2020 to 25. There are missionaries working right now in places like Sri Lanka, Malawi, Indonesia, Cambodia, and veiled countries where preaching the gospel is against the law. There are many mission challenges because in some places where there is no Adventist presence, it takes 2 years of sharing the love of Jesus with non-Christians who live in these areas before they open their hearts to Christ. Please give sacrificially to support these missionaries and pray for these missionaries and their families. We invite you to go through prayer, go through giving, and go through service. And then, you know, Matthew 24:14, and this gospel of the kingdom will be preached throughout all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. Is anybody else ready for the end besides me? I'm ready. This world doesn't have much to offer anymore. Anyhow, Owen and Robbie will bring in around some pumpkins to sign. And then, obviously, the children's offering. Anyhow, will the deacons please stand? Dear kind Heavenly Father, we only thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day that we all have to come to worship you today. I would ask that we would all give liberally to this offering, and you have blessed us with so much. So I'd ask that these offerings go to its intended use, and I would ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
time for a children's story. Come on up, kids. Welcome. Come on.
Thank you. All right. Let's try that again. Happy Sabbath. Perfect. All right. So the story I have for you guys today is actually something that happened to me last year. So when I first came here, which is last year, I'm actually originally from across the country. I'm from a state called Florida. And no, I don't do a ton of Disney World, unlike what they think. But here's the thing about Florida. We have alligators, we have water moccasins, and we have like all these dangerous animals that are poisonous and all this stuff. So when I came out here, I thought, oh, there's no alligators, so there's nothing to be worried about when I go out in nature. Boy, was I wrong. So one night, me and my roommate, which is McKenna right there, we decide we are very bored, and so we decide to go hiking in the back 40 at night. Don't do this. So we start walking up. We start heading down to the back 40. We're walking our way up there. We're talking. We're laughing. And all of a sudden, we hear something in the bushes rustling. And I just barely, I go, and McKenna jumps like 20 feet in the air and like pulls me back like I saw something humongous. And I was like, it was just a mouse. She's like, no, it could have been something big. It could have been something big. Ah. So we keep walking. And we're heading down the path. Now, if you've been in the back 40, there's a lot of cow pastures. It's cow land because the PUC is very famous for having cattle. And that's how it actually started in the 1800s. It was cattle school. It started with cattle. So as we're walking down, we're heading down, and we suddenly realized we got very, very lost. And it's pitch black outside. And we're just standing there, and we're walking still. And then all of a sudden, both of us stop, and we're like, should we keep going? I don't know. This doesn't feel right. I feel something in my gut telling me this isn't right. And I shouldn't keep going. But we ignored it because we're stubborn. And we kept going because I was like, I know where we're going. And McKenna's like, are you sure? Are you sure you know where we're going? And I'm like, yes, I've done this a million times. I still walk. And then finally I stop. And she's like, you're lost, aren't you? I'm like, yeah. So we finally walk all the way back. But the thing is, by this point, it was so dark outside, and we already had to walk clean down the mountain all by ourselves. And if you don't know, there are mountain lions in this area. And so we were terrified of walking down and getting eaten, because at the time, there were actually some mountain lion sightings in the area. We were very nervous. So as we were going down, we just like kept walking slower and slower. And we slowly weighed our way down, and we got there safely. But I think what I learned in this instance is that I should listen to that still small voice in my gut, because that's the Holy Spirit protecting me. Because God has this beautiful ability to protect us. Whether we like it or not, whether we're stubborn, we don't listen to it or not, God inherently wants to protect us because he loves us. And so the verse that I have to go with found in Proverbs. It's going to be Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. God made my path clear that I needed to go back home in my bed where I belonged. And he can make your path clear. Even if it's pitch black outside and you don't know where the next step is, God has a plan for you. All right, and that's my story. You can head back to your seats.
Good morning, church family. Today, this scripture reading is found in your hymnals on page 700.
Wait for them to find it. It's between 699 and 701, just in case anyone was wondering about that. You will read the light print.
I will read the light print, and you guys will read the dark print. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name.
Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nation, his wonders among all peoples.
For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the peoples are idols. But the Lord made the heavens.
Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary.
Give to the Lord, O kindreds of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength.
Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth.
Say among the nations, the Lord reigns, the Lord, the world as is firmly established. He shall judge the peoples righteously.
Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar in all its fullness. Let the field be joyful, and all that is in it. Then all the trees of the woods will rejoice before the Lord.
For he is coming. To judge the earth. He shall judge the world with his righteousness, and the peoples will with his truth.
Amen.
Good morning, church family. Boy, when I came in, there was like five people in here, so it's nice to see how we've grown. Before I start talking about MindFit, there are two things I want to say. First off, the shoe boxes are due by next week, so if you haven't turned it in, please do. Secondly, there's something else I'd like to talk about. So, Pastor, would you come up, please?
You can.
Pastor?
I'm sorry. I don't have a fit mind, so if you're looking for...
No, okay. No.
I thought it was... Oh.
So, last month, October, was Pastor Appreciation Month, and I was a little slow on the uptake. But we got there, so today we're going to honor you because we so appreciate everything you've done for our church. We so enjoy having you. And we did a little fundraising for your sick car. I understand.
Really?
You've had a sick transmission?
Yes, terminal.
So,
terminal diagnosis on the car.
Well, you can't be revived?
It can, yes, okay. Perhaps with this
from
envelope.
Yeah. So this envelope
put the envelope on the engine and boom.
There you go. Well, it might help.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
I'm so grateful. Wow. I don't know how to thank you so much.
I'm sorry it's so late. We didn't
it's
forget.
Okay.
We're just slow.
I'm blessed. Blessings. Thank you, everyone. Blessings.
Okay. I talked a little bit about MindFit last week, but Daniel, can you show the video first this time, and then I'll talk a little bit more.
My issues. Uh, My issues just made people uncomfortable. The way that they handled that was just to avoid me.
Do you have any good scars? And she said, Andrew, I do. Some of them I can show you and some I cannot.
The word asylum actually means a place of refuge or sanctuary.
Lobotomies or electroshock. They did insulin therapy, ice water therapy.
There's the logical part of your brain, which is the frontal lobe, and then there's the emotional part of your brain, which is the limbic system.
They lack hope. They feel like others are against them, their illness is against them.
Depression is the leading cause of disability worldwide.
Your amygdala goes, I have to survive. I want comfort.
It feels like you have this lead jacket on. You can barely walk.
Swimming is actually very therapeutic. You can cry and no one knows.
On this side, you have reckless, careless. You get to the other side where we find panic, fear, you freeze.
I sit on the edge of my bed for 30 minutes just contemplating what to put on. Who cares? They're clothes.
One of the amazing things about the human brain is that it is highly plastic. It's very changeable.
If you had diabetes, would you take insulin? If you needed glasses, would you wear glasses? Like, you have a chemical imbalance, but your limbic system is in overdrive.
Stigma is not biological. Cultural laws are sometimes arbitrary, but they're still binding.
And the stigma is the umbrella. Embarrassment, pride, macho. Well, is everybody good? And everybody's not good.
What we're really talking about is who we are, who we were meant to be.
It's just a biological issue.
Well, it is, but it's more than that. It's a social issue, it's a relational issue, it's a spiritual issue. Let's just start with the reality. They're not separable.
Join me in hundreds of churches around North America as we implement Christ's method and tackle the real crisis of mental health. Together, we will mingle with our community, show our sympathy, and meet their needs, which in so doing will reflect the love of Jesus to a dying world. For more information, visit us at mindfitevent.com/host.
I have to say, this is pretty personal to me. My grandmother was given electric shock for depression, and she was never the same. She lost a lot of memories. So I think this is going to be a wonderful program that we're going to do here at the church, January 2 through 5. It's Thursday through Sunday nights, 7 o'clock. First half hour will be a video by Alex Rodriguez talking about it, and then we're going to have everybody who participates will have a study guide, and we're going to talk about how God helps us get through this. So I'm going to have a lot of material to distribute in the next 2 weeks, but until then, I really, really hope all of you pray just to think about who you might know, even yourself, that could benefit from this, because you can see it's a rampant problem. I guess 1 in 5 suffer from anxiety or depression. So just start praying, please, that you come across those people who would benefit from this program. It's free, and it's just something that I think is going to be a great outreach for our community. Thank you.
I want to thank you for promoting that special event, Deborah. That beginning event in January will be the first in a year-long series of outreach events that we're going to be doing to our community. And so we have an ambitious evangelism plan. We ask that you pray with us about that and partner with us. And it's not just us. It's us in the school and us in the hospital and us in the thrift store and all their other partners in the community. So we praise the Lord for the fellowship and friendships that we have with our other organizations. Today's sermon is entitled, Sing a New Song. And I was invited by a girl that I had a crush on to join a choir in my senior year. And men do things for strange reasons at 17 years old. And so I thought, You know, this girl invited me to choir. I thought I would be standing next to her and smelling her hair or something like that. But she stood in a whole other section of soprano section, and they put me in this bass section. And I discovered the joy of singing. I had sung songs before like Jingle Bells and Rocking Around the Christmas Tree. But we were taught in this choir, it was a seasonal thing, and we were taught songs like Joy to the World and In the Bleak Midwinter and O Little Town of Bethlehem. And we had these golden choir robes that they gave us, and we were bused down to the San Diego Wild Animal Park, and we were caroling for the community. And I, you know, got into choir for improper motives, but the choir blessed me with a new refined sense. I discovered that I was a bass and that I could not stretch beyond that bass. And so when I discovered the joy of singing, I really embraced it. Now, many of you may simply be singing in the shower or in your car, and I won't ask you if you sing pop songs in your car or not, but my main idea with this sermon is that we need to learn the value of a song down here, because we will not be taught a new song in heaven when we get there. It will be the song of the Lamb and the song of Moses that we sing, but we have to learn it here. There's no second chance to get to understand the song in the new earth. Sure, we'll learn new songs, but not the song we must sing before Jesus comes. And as Robbie read so well, I must just give a tip of the cap here to our teachers, because our kids are thriving in the Foothill School. Praise the Lord. Robbie's reading so well, and Izzy reading so well. And this Psalm 96 was the source for the responsive reading that we did. This is the Lord's power, a call to worship the Lord, the righteous judge. Can you have a more relevant song for the people of judgment like us? Sing a new song. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim good tidings of his salvation from day to day. The theme of our song must be salvation. When we adopt Christ as our Savior, we are given a new passport. Our citizenship of the world is sublimated to the citizenship of heaven. And Jesus allows us to become citizens of the kingdom of heaven. Ephesians 2:19, so then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and are of God's household. Praise the Lord. For our citizenship is in heaven, Philippians 3:20, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And then 1 Peter 2:11 and 12, beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lust, which wage war against the soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, because of your good deeds as they observe them, glorify God in the day of visitation. Incredible to think that when we go about our daily good deeds as Christians, reflecting the glory of the Lord, people may be impressed to seek him. Just maybe they might be impressed to seek him. That was taken, by the way, from a pamphlet, 24 Ways to Explain the Gospel. Another passage from 2 Peter 3:13 gives us perspective on this. You see, according to his promise, we are looking for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Praise the Lord. That's not this world. Righteousness is a foreign concept to this world. But when we see Jesus coming, we'll say, lo, this is our Redeemer. We have waited for him. And it's an eager anticipation. More eager from than a child waiting for their birthday, America waiting for Christmas or Black Friday, whatever it is, you can anticipate high. And I propose to you and I challenge you that your anticipation is not enough. My anticipation is not enough. Because what we're waiting for, we don't even imagine yet. We can describe it through the prophecies, but we can't imagine it. And the artists try to show us pictures like this that only give us a glimpse into it. So, for three sections of this message, I want to look at Miriam's song, Exodus 16, also known as Moses' song, but it's attributed to Miriam because of a couple verses I'll show you. Then we have Moses' song in Deuteronomy 32, and of course at the close of the apocalypse, the song of the Lamb. And so we'll turn to Exodus chapter 15 in our Bibles and review this important song. You see, the Israelites had been free in Egypt, correct? They were free in Egypt? No, gotcha. The Israelites were enslaved in Egypt. The first chapter of Exodus reveals that a Pharaoh came who did not know Joseph. And so he put them in chains and urged them to build their cities. And did they exit on friendly terms with the Pharaoh? No, it was not friendly terms. In fact, we have a grieving Pharaoh who has lost his firstborn son and majority of his kingdom through plagues, frogs, red blood Nile, flies. You know, I'd like to think that after the third plague, I would say, you know what? Go before everything's gone. But I'm not as smart as Pharaoh, and I'm not as holy as Jesus yet. But he allowed his whole nation to be ravaged by his pride. And so he chased them. They were threatened with destruction. They had no place to go. They had Pharaoh's army approaching them. They had the Red Sea behind them. But God intervened. He sent a pillar of fire to block their way. And then he told Moses, put your rod in the Red Sea. And the sea parted. And it's common vernacular. And when you're in the carpool lane, you love that when the cars all pull over and you go. It's like the parting of the Red Sea, they say. Well, Exodus 15 happens after that tremendous event. And verses 2 through 5 give us the theme of salvation. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. You see the theme of the song? This is my God, and I will praise him. My Father's God, and I will extol him. This salvation was a reality that they had just experienced. It was a tangible freedom, substantive, that they had had. Their Egyptian overlords and their taskmasters were washed upon the beach, dead. Hallelujah! And Israel lived in peace forevermore. Amen and amen. No, not really. The reason we call it Miriam's song is because of verses 20 and 21. Miriam, the prophetess, Aaron's sister, took the timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dancing. And it quotes in verse 21, it's a quote of the song, sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted, horse and rider thrown into the sea. Some of us haven't remembered that song that we sung when we were kids. So verses 2 through 5, the theme of salvation. Verses 6 through 10 of the song, the omnipotence of God. Your right hand, O Lord, is majestic in power. Your right hand, O Lord, shatters the enemy. So it is focused on God's amazing power. That word omnipotence is all powerful. Potency is another word we get from that. And then in verses 11 through 18, looking ahead to glory in a future homeland. Does that have relevance for us in this day and age? We must look ahead to heaven. We can't focus on this world. We'll get too discouraged if we do. Verses 11, who is like you among the gods, O Lord? Who is like you? Majestic in holiness, awesome in praises, working wonders. And so Miriam's song is sung. But notice verse 22. It didn't take too long, but one verse for them to sink into complaining and discouragement. Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur, and they went 3 days. So it's only 3 days later. They found no water. When they came to Marah, they could not drink the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. 3 days after crossing the Red Sea, starting to complain. Man, if only we were not like them. And I say that sardonically, of course. When we examine these things, we must remember that it's got to be fresh. The salvation gospel message has to be fresh from the Holy Spirit to encourage us to remain faithful to Him. You see, the word Exodus means the way out. That's the original. It's true. It's an Old Testament book, but it's a Greek title. And here's a quote from Education. How often in spiritual experience is this history repeated? How often by words of holy song are unsealed in the soul the springs of penitence of faith and faith, of hope and love and joy. You see, they had this experience with the complaining at the bitter waters. They had the experience of, would that we had died in Egypt, Exodus 16, verse 3. And Moses, through the Lord, provided for them the what is it. Now, I say manna because the Hebrew word manna means what is it. And it really still is a mystery to this day. I have been fed some things that were purportedly manna, but I won't know until I get it in heaven. And notice, as Moses goes up, in chapter 19, he's going up to the mountain with Joshua, and he's about to get the what God had spoke to them on the mountain, he's going to get in code form on the tablets of stone. But what's happening down at the base of the mountain when God is getting not only the Ten Commandments, but the plans for the tabernacle, the instructions for the priests, and the way that they would, it was civil laws also that God was giving, not just the Ten Commandments. What was happening? What was Aaron doing? Right. Exactly. And it couldn't last a few days without an idol to worship. And so when we get to the time, at that point, God could have said extra 40 years, but he didn't. He led him all the way to the promised land, sent in the 12 spies, which we had a majority opinion come back that they're too big for us, they'll crush us. God is not with us. That's the majority opinion of the 10 spies. Two spies, Joshua and Caleb, let's go. Don't you remember when we were facing Pharaoh's army, what did God do? He provided. And so, despite being brought through the most magnificent deliverance, the Israelites strayed from that plan, and they rebelled again at Kadesh Barnea, and they couldn't go in. They could see it. They could see the promised land, and they couldn't go in. And so, at the end of Deuteronomy, in chapters 31 through 34, we have here the final sermon, I want to go back, the final sermon, a message of Moses to the people. And I have a little outline here. In chapter 31, we have a new leader, and that is Joshua, Jesus, for lack of a better, Yeshua, the New Testament name of Jesus is Joshua, Old Testament means Savior. And so in chapter 31, he has this description here. And look what he says in verse 14. Behold, the time for you to die is near, call Joshua and present yourselves at the tent of meeting so that I may commission him. So Moses and Joshua went and presented themselves at the tent of meeting. And Joshua is given the mantle of leadership from Moses. And that's chapter 31. Chapter 32 is a new song. Above and beyond Miriam's song, Deuteronomy 32 contains a song of Moses. Now, we'll look at that in closer detail in a moment, but the summary is that they would fall away. God foresaw that they would fall away. And then in chapter 33, even despite their falling away, Moses gives the blessing on them in chapter 33. And then in chapter 34, in 33, the new blessing, and then chapter 34, the new home, Canaan. And so let's look at this new song that they're given. You see, Moses reminded the people of God's blessings. God found them in the desert. He loved them and sheltered them. He lifted them up to high places of victory. He gave them the richest blessings of the land. But what does Israel do? The nation rebels. In verses 15 through 18, we have a description of Israel's apostasy and idolatry. They're forsaking their rock and forgetting his love. By the way, in chapter 32, specifically, we see here, verse 4, the rock. What was it that provided the water for Israel in the wilderness? The rock, right? That rock where the water flowed, that's the term for God here. And notice, verses 15 through 17, I think I have that here, 15 through 18. Notice, when Israel, I'll back up and say this. My common name is Vince. People call me Vince, Pastor Vince, buddy, dude, late, whatever they call me. So, Jeshurun is the, like, the first, last, middle name, whatever. That's the negative name that God gives Israel. And here he calls them that. Jeshurun grew fat and kicked. You are grown fat, thick, and sleek. Then he forsook God who made him and scorned the rock of his salvation. There it is again, the rock. They made him jealous with strange gods. With abominations, they provoked him to anger. And God points to idolatry for what it really is. They sacrificed to demons who were not God, to gods whom they have not known, new gods who came lately, whom your fathers did not dread. You neglected the rock who begot you and forgot the God who gave you birth. Wow. Idolatry is demon worship. Plain and simple. There it is in the text. And even though Moses foretold that this would happen, it still came about. And God rebukes them, yet he still blesses them. That's amazing grace of God. And one step leads to another. This is from the Bible commentary on this passage. One step leads to another until there may result a complete reversal of one's former conduct. Yet it seems almost beyond belief that God's chosen people could have worshipped devils and offered their own sons and daughters as sacrificial offerings. To stray from God's path may lead to the most fearful alternatives, as it did for Israel. And after this reminder of Moses' song, look at chapter 33. The Lord came from Sinai and dawned on them from Seir. He shone from Mount Paran, and he came from the midst of 10,000 holy ones. At his right hand, there was flashing lightning for them. Do you think it was a mystery to the angels when God said, you know, I'm gonna hang out down here on this little fallen planet with these rebels? I would have been perplexed if I was an angel. I mean, the unfallen worlds worship him in undaunted and untainted glory. But God chose to be among Israelites in that little tabernacle tent with the badger skins. Verses 2 and 3. Indeed, he loves the people. That's not a New Testament concept. God's love for us says it right here. Indeed, he loves the people. All your holy ones are in your hand, and they followed in your steps. Everyone receives of your words. The cross is that pathway from barren wilderness landscape to abundance, life, and hope. Hallelujah for that. Here's a quote from In Heavenly Places, page 248. In fact, this is when I looked up Psalm 96, this is what it gave me. Genuine conversion will unite our hearts in what? Faith and love. It will teach us to hold fast our confidence in him who is our only hope. By conversion, we join our weakness to God's strength, our ignorance to his wisdom, our unworthiness to his merits, our poverty to his boundless riches, our hopelessness to his enduring might. Praise the Lord. That's a song I want to sing. Have you ever heard the expression Whistling Dixie? It can be used in a positive way or a negative way. It's usually said, well, he ain't just whistling Dixie, right? You ever heard someone say that? Well, Dixie and Dixieland was the Confederate anthem during the Civil War. And had the South won the Civil War, that might be our national anthem today. But when someone is whistling Dixie, as it's described there, they generally hint that someone is overly optimistic or wasting time on unrealistic hopes or plans. Are our redemption songs like that? The world sees it that way, but we do not. And it may be a mystery to the world why we sing songs like do Lord, oh, do remember me, right? But for us, people of faith, it's got a deeper meaning. All us boys are going to heaven, right? That kind of thing, you know? You understand what I mean. Let's turn our focus now to the Song of the Lamb, Revelation chapter 15, this prophetic message of a people seen in heaven among the redeemed. Then I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous. Seven angels who had seven plagues, which are the last, because in them the wrath of God is finished. And I saw something like a sea of glass mixed with fire, and those who had been victorious over the beast and his image and the number of his name standing on the sea of glass holding harps of God. And they sang the song of Moses, the bondservant of God, and the song of the Lamb. Now look at the focus of the song. Is the redeemed the focus of the song or the redeemer the focus of the song? You see, that's the switch within conversion, because the unconverted heart relies on itself. The converted heart relies on the redeemer. Great and marvelous are your works, O Lord God the Almighty. Righteous and true are your ways, King of the nations. Notice the similarities between the Song of Miriam and the Song of Moses. Salvation at the heart. Verse 4, who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy, for all the nations will come and worship before you, for your righteous acts have been revealed. And there in the margin, we have references to Revelation 14:7, Jeremiah 10:7, Psalm 86:9, and Isaiah 66:23. This song is not going to be taught in heaven. We must learn it here. We've got to learn these songs and remain faithful, not keep falling and being in those traps that Israel had. When Adam Clark comments on this passage, he says, they sing the song of Moses. When he and the Israelites, by the miraculous power of God, had got safely through the Red Sea and saw their enemies all destroyed. The same song adapted to the state of the suffering, but now delivered Christians. This picture is just an artist's rendition of what it will be like, but can you just imagine? If we brought the truth into the daily life as we should, we would advance higher and still higher, gaining a clearer and still clearer understanding of the revelation of God. We would lift him up in songs of praise. Through the psalmist, Christ declared, "In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee." Psalm 22:22. Remember that that is the Good Friday psalm as well. Can you imagine Jesus Christ suffering on the cross? And we know that was on top of his mind because he says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" His voice was the keynote of the universe. His unconfined power, his unsearchable understanding, his wonderful sacrifice for the human race, help us to comprehend the love of God. We need individually to have Christ abiding in the soul. We need to open our minds and hearts to the indwelling of the Spirit of truth. We need to appreciate our privileges as the possessors of sacred, elevating truth. Think of what this means to us. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. Incredible to think. And as I close with this illustration, Rachel and Jackie, we can prepare to sing our closing song. A sailor was in a shipwreck, and he was thrown upon a rock where he clung in great danger until the tide went down. Later, a friend asked him, "Jim, didn't you shake with fear when you were hanging on that rock?" Jim's response, "Yes, but the rock didn't shake." That was the significant reply, because Christ is the Rock of Ages.
All right, our last song is on page 216 in your hymnals, "When the Roll is Called Up Yonder."
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll called up yonder, I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder,
I'm going to give you a preview of what I want to talk about next week, but in Revelation chapter 19, we have the fourfold hallelujah. After these things I heard, something like a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, "Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, because his judgments are true and righteous. For he has judged the great harlot who was corrupting the earth with her immorality, and he has avenged the blood of his bondservants on her." Lord in heaven, we praise you and thank you for your salvation. And we ask to be renewed with a sense of singing and praise this Thanksgiving season. And we ask for you to teach us this song so that we can sing it with the unnumbered redeemed and the world made new. Help us to sing that song down here so that someone else may learn the song for themselves. We pray this in Jesus' wonderful and precious name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you, Haven Church.